We're going to structure the 7th day, which is devoted to this discussion of the system development life cycle. And it's somewhat different from the rest of the chapters in the book because it is more at the conceptual level. It's not really directly about what you're going to be doing in your project, and it's not about any hands-on experience, but it is still nonetheless very important because the objective is to give you an idea of how systems are different. And you will see that with very high likelihood you're going to be affected by a process like what we discussed, start discussing today. There is this basic question that people ask: why would you want to develop a new system, assuming you are a continuing business? If you start a new business, you have to put a system in place. But if you are a continuing business, you must have some kind of a system, even if it is a paper-based system. You do have a system because otherwise you cannot know what's going on in your business. So why would people spend money and effort to put a new system in place? There are basically three reasons. And you will see that in many cases, all three actually provide some motivation. So one is that you need to do something and the system that you have doesn't do it. For example, you see that everybody around you accepts credit cards. You don't have an infrastructure accept a credit card, so you have to put some kind of a system in place, right? At the very least, you have to procure the terminals that will be able to read the cards connected to the credit card processing system, make sure that that information is captured and stored in your old system, so there is some work involved, right? So it's going to be new. And this is very, very common. I can tell you that about, I would say, 10 years ago. That was the time when most big companies already had ERP systems in place, for quite a while. We'll talk about that. So that, you remember, that was a big rush in the second half of the 1990s. 10 years later, they all had ERP systems in place. And then many large companies realized that there was this new technology which was becoming available called RFID. Radio frequency identifiers. And it really provided great new capabilities in managing your inventory, organizing your warehouses, keeping track of all that stuff. And the problem was that the existing ERP systems actually couldn't handle it, simply because the volume of information that was generated by RFID readers was so huge that some serious upgrades needed to be done. So they had to upgrade to this newer version of the system because they wanted to use this technology. Walmart was one of the pioneers, but a lot of other companies followed. This is also an example that, there is a new technology. So RFID was a new technology. So when a new technology becomes available, you're going to be facing this dilemma. Oh, well, probably when you start, it's going to be above your pay grade, but sooner or later, you'll get it, or your company will be facing this dilemma that, okay, do we rush in, do we wait, but sooner or later, you will have to do this. By the way, what probably happened almost on your watch, there were these updates to the systems that allowed the system to talk directly to mobile devices. So early versions of the systems were all designed to work with standard computers, including desktop computers and laptops. And 10 years ago, when iPhone appeared, so this mobile revolution really started. And a few years later, I would say probably 5 or 6 years ago, the companies started rushing into this space and updating their systems to be able to accommodate these new devices. So these days you will see a lot of people who work for companies, they will be able to do a lot of stuff on their phones. And it doesn't happen by itself, you really have to make this happen. And finally, competition. if you are in a competitive business segment, for example, retail, you know that retail is fiercely competitive. So it's an area with very, very thin margins. So, you know, people know that Walmart is the biggest retailer in the world, but I don't know if all people realize that Walmart runs an incredibly sophisticated operation. You know, the people usually think, well, they sell cheap stuff, right? But they actually, they have highly automated back office. So, and they really, they're one of the leaders in deploying new information technology. So it's not a coincidence that when RFID became available, Walmart was a pioneer, and they actually forced some of their major suppliers to start adding RFID labels to the pallets of goods that they were selling to Walmart, because that allowed Walmart to keep track of it much easier, much better. So those kind of obvious issues, but you know, in every special case you'll see that you have to think about. So this pie chart is just this basic philosophical observation that it doesn't matter what kind of systems we deal with, whether they're biological systems or whether they're technological systems, any system has to be created. So there's this creation stage, then the system is getting started, and then there is hopefully this long and productive stage of maturity, but sooner or later every system declines and dies. And this pie chart cannot be done to scale, because if you try to draw it to scale, then those slices that represent creation and startup, they would be very, very small. Okay, and the decline also probably much, much smaller. Maturity is by far the longest stage, hopefully, if you design the system. So we are going to be focusing mostly on the first two slices. So we're going to be focusing on this creation stage and the startup. And what we are going to be discussing in this chapter is this methodology, which is now called, so it has a name which is called System Development Lifecycle, SDLC. This methodology is not new. You can trace the origins probably around 50 years back, but people started really talking in those terms about 40 years ago. And what forced the development of this methodology? So when computers started making their way into supporting business operations, and so what generated significant demand for computers and the development of operating systems and other things, so more and more people were getting involved in developing new computer systems. And so when they started doing this on a large scale in the early to mid 1960s, they faced a very, very strange situation. So, you know, people have been doing developments for quite a while, right? So our industrial civilization is more than 200 years old, you know, and before that, even before industrialization. So there has been tremendous experience accumulated. And it turned out that most of that experience didn't apply. That these projects that involved the development of large-scale software systems didn't behave like normal technological projects behave. So what do I mean? Well, you know, you're running the project, you want to do something. And you start doing it, that it's really tough going, and you see that you're behind schedule. So if you want to catch up, what would you do normally? What people typically did? So what do you think? So you're digging a ditch, right? And it turns out that the soil is very, very hard, right? Let's say you use shovels. So you keep digging, you have a deadline, you see that you're not going to meet the deadline the way it's going. So if you have to meet the deadline, what are you going to do? So it's a very simple question. What? Well, what if there are no two? Well, I mean, the technology is given. Yeah, I understand. Yeah, so it's, if you can excavate, right? So that will go much faster. Let's say that you have to use shovels. So you're digging and you're behind schedule because the soil is harder. The earth that you have to get is much harder. So what are you going to do? It's actually, it's a very simple question. Yeah, get more diggers, right? So it's kind of common sense thing. So you are behind schedule, you see that actually it takes more, so you throw more resources at it. And obviously I'm exaggerating with this ditch digging, but this is what works, right? Not only in commercial projects and military projects. So when they faced the same situation with developing software, they use the same solution. So if it starts going really slowly, you want to speed it up, why don't we hire more programmers? Okay? And to their surprise, the result was just the opposite, usually. So you try to throw more programmers at this, and in some cases it starts going even slow. So these projects didn't really behave in a normal way. Another very, very strange thing that people encountered was that you know that the variation in labor productivity was absolutely extreme. Say you have diggers who dig a ditch, right? So some actually dig better than others. That's normal, right? So it always happens, right? Some people are better. So if you look at this, and again, you're running this business, you're looking at labor productivity, you see how much they dig. Let's say that you get the slowest digger and the fastest digger. What do you think would be the difference in their output? As a ratio, how many times would the fastest digger be faster than the slowest digger? And let's assume that people are actually digging. They are doing their best. They are not just, you know, trying to waste your time. I mean, it's purely on the basis of their abilities. Just make a wild guess. I would venture a guess, probably a factor of 3. So that you have a really, really powerful guy and a weaker guy, and the powerful guy probably can dig 3 times faster. Okay. Now, with this business programming, the variations were absolutely wild. So it's very easy to see cases where one outputs 10 times as much as another one. And again, assuming that people work. And even more. And again, this is just a different kind of a thing. You know, first of all, why do we see a problem with adding simply more programmers? Well, because programming happens in your head, right? And it's not like, you know, you're facing a difficult task. It's like solving a math problem, right? So you're trying to solve a math problem and you're running out of time. You add more people saying, okay, why don't you all solve math here, the same math problem together? Is it going to go any faster? Well, it depends on how difficult the math problem is. In many cases, may not, because they start talking to each other and just waste time instead of concentrating. Okay, so it's a different type of activity. And people started facing this in the actually mid-1960s. So when I was, I think I was still an undergraduate student, probably around my 4th year. In the early 1980s, I read a very interesting book. So the author was Brooks Jr. And it's called The Mythical Man Month. So this guy, in the 1960s, in the mid-1960s, he was in charge of developing an operating system for the IBM mainframes. So they got this system 360, which IBM was planning to release, and they were developing operating systems, so they actually had a number of different operating systems. So he was in charge of developing an OS 360. And that was a very large-scale project with a lot of programmers. And he already faced all those issues. You know, so what is interesting about this is that people run into this early point. and they realize that, okay, so this is something different. It doesn't look like what we have dealt with before. And so we have to find a way how to keep those projects under control. It costs a lot of money, it takes a very long time, so you have to find a way how to keep it under control. So, or, by the way, the book is fascinating. I believe they probably even sell it now. I read the first edition, I think there was a second edition. I saw it, I think, in the 1990s. My sense is probably still in print. It's a really profound book, one of the early books that led to the development of a new discipline, which is called software engineering, how you run all those large-scale software projects. So, in the 1970s, all these thoughts culminated in the development of this actually, new methodology called System Development Lifecycle. In this chapter, it is presented as a five-stage methodology. So first you do system analysis, then you design your system, then you implement the system, develop the system, implement the system, and finally you bring the system into operations and maintain the system. So, if you look at some other books, you may see in some cases it is presented as four stages, in some cases it is presented as six stages, but the content is the same. So, by now it is more or less standard. So, there is even a course about this. Maybe we still teach it. I know for sure, we used to teach a course called Design and Development of Information Systems, which was loosely based on this methodology. So here, this is just what the framework is. It is usually presented as this picture. It's known as a waterfall diagram. Waterfall diagram of system development lifecycle. So you see that first it shows you the sequencing of the stages that you do the analysis first, then you do the design, then you do the development, then you do the implementation, and then you do operations. What is also interesting that you see here feedback loops. This kind. So, what is the significance of those feedback loops? So, they signify the fact that as you go through this structured process, very often you will find yourself in a situation where what you discover at a stage in the process forces you to backtrack, to go back to the previous stage and reconsider some of the decisions and some of the solutions that you developed in the previous stage. So there is this back and forth. It is necessary. It also causes problems. So I will mention those problems next week when we complete the chapter. So it really depends how open you have to do this. Any questions? Okay, so who does this? Well, obviously there are information systems professionals who have to be involved in this, but it is also important to emphasize that a lot of people who are not information system professionals are always involved in developing and deploying new business information systems. And their participation is absolutely critical because they are the people who will have to use the system, who will have to run the system. And ultimately, the success or failure of the system will depend on those people. How they like the system, whether the system meets their needs, if they're properly trained or not to use the system. So, therefore, the involvement of end users is absolutely critical, right? And this is the reason why we talk to you about this. So you're not gonna, most of you are not gonna become information system professionals. But you, most surely, will be among those end users who are going to be affected by this and very often will have to participate in the team which will put the new system in place. So these systems are expensive. If you're talking about large companies and major ERP systems, it will easily go into millions. So it's not like getting a new version of Microsoft Office. And they also will take very significant time to develop. So we are talking many months. Hopefully not years. There are cases where it took years. If it takes years, it's already a huge problem. So the process that you put in place, when you develop a new system will affect the kind of a system you are going to build. So that's why it's really important to be prepared to know what to expect. Okay? So you can be users, you can be members of the development team. You may also be auditors, by the way. The auditors have to review the systems to understand what they do and to what extent they can develop the information in the system. Okay, so now what we're going to do, we're going to take one by one, the five stages of the system development lifecycle and briefly discuss what happens in each stage. With the understanding that design and development will be just discussed at a high level here, and in the subsequent material of the course, some of those issues and concepts will be discussed in more detail. So what is systems analysis? It includes requirements analysis, system survey, and feasibility analysis. So what is requirements analysis? So the objective is to understand the capabilities that the new system has to provide and the user's needs that it has to fulfill. Okay? So to know clearly what the system is supposed to do. And it sounds like a really easy question. So if you tell people that, okay, this is what you have to do, then their natural response will be, okay, why don't you just ask those people who will have to use the system, and they're going to tell you. And yes, of course, this is what is done. Yeah. You ask those people. You actually ask them in a number of different ways. You can conduct interviews and try to elicit this kind of information in the course of an interview. This is actually a very tricky task. It requires a lot of expertise. It's like, you know, when we talked about this class, I told you that, you know, you will get most use of the out of your classroom time if you ask me questions. Now, it's difficult to know what to ask, so it's not easy. So a person who conducts an interview really has to be a rather senior person who has seen a lot of things and can direct an interview in the direction that will allow them to find out what is going on. This is a fairly unstructured activity. You can have a plan for an interview, but you know, as they say about battle plans, that no battle plan ever survives the first contact with the enemy. So the same applies to the interview. So you can plan it, but then when you start going through all those issues, it will take you in some directions that you may not expect. So as such, so this activity is expensive. Interviewing is expensive. It requires significant resources on your part, and expensive resources, very, very experienced, and a lot of time, and significant resources on the part of the other party, on the part of the users, because you also need fairly high users. So for that reason, you cannot really conduct too many interviews. So you have to be very selective in who you ask and who is doing the asking. So therefore, you cannot really cover the whole ground. And so the interviews are always conducted, but as I said, they are fairly selective. When you want to figure out what the system requirements are, you want to expand the set of people that you get information from. And you cannot do it with an interview. So what can you do? You can distribute questionnaires. Questionnaires are very structured. So you prepare it, you put some questions in there, and then you can administer it to a large number of users. So usually you cannot put too many questions in your questionnaire. You have to be selective, because if you give somebody a questionnaire with 100 questions, you can be sure, but when they get close to the middle, they just mark whatever. So, by the way, there are people who professionally do this. So it's a part of research methodology. So there are experts who know how to develop questionnaires. And again, it sounds simple, it's not. Because when you are dealing with human beings, nothing is simple. You may ask the same question, and if you ask it differently, you can ask it in a positive form, or you can ask it in a negative form, you may get different answers. Okay? You may ask exactly the same thing, rephrasing it, and you again may get different answers. Also, an answer may depend on what was asked before. Okay? So there is this anchoring effect. So there are a lot of subtleties. So it takes very significant expertise to prepare a questionnaire and also to know what you really want to ask. By the way, that's why interviews usually come first. So you actually figure out what the areas are that you need to cover, and then you put a significant effort into developing the questionnaire. The good part is that after the questionnaire is developed, that the mechanics of administering it and the coverage can be very significant. So the mechanics these days, you know, you can easily do it on the web. So in the old days, it was done on paper. So the mechanics now is really easy, right? And you can cover a very large number of users with this. But you have to be very careful when you develop the question. In many cases, it's not enough. Why? Because there is a very high likelihood that neither the interviews nor the questionnaires can reveal certain significant aspects of what a system is supposed to do, simply because users who do their work day in and day out, they don't always rationalize and reflect on what they do and why. You know, it's not like, you know, you ask people and they don't want to tell you. They want to tell you, just they may not realize that a certain thing that they do actually is important to know for the system development. So that's why there is this other activity which is called observation of activities. So this is actually a rather tricky thing, not done very often because it is time consuming. You have to put a system developer in a situation where they can see directly what the end users are doing. Now, in many cases, you want to avoid creating an impression that those users have been monitored, because monitoring affects behavior. Okay? So, why do I distribute the attendance sheet? Well, I need it for my purposes if I to know that the student just skipped too many classes. But another reason is just since you know that your attendance has been monitored, it affects your decision whether you're going to come to this class or not. So the same happens with the observations. So you really would like in this case to avoid creating an impression that the end user's activities have been monitored. And how do you do that? Well, there have been quite a few documented cases where system analysts would go undercover, so to speak. They would say they want to understand what is happening on the shop floor, what kind of activities are conducted there, what kind of information is flowing, and they don't want really to change anything. They may join the crew as a member of the team and work there for a month or two to figure out what is going on. As I said, it's really tiring. But in some cases it has to be done if you're not really getting very good answers. And the end users cannot articulate clearly what is going on and what the information needs. Also, you can look at the documents that they work with. You assume that probably they would want a new system to generate the same kind of documents and reports, and that will also give you an indication of what piece of information is going to be needed. So this is what is known as the requirements analysis. Another one is system survey. So this is where you look at the existing system try to understand what it does, what it does well, what it does poorly. Inevitably, when people look at, say, pre-ERP systems, homegrown systems, file-based systems, they realize that one of the very significant weaknesses of those systems was the lack of integration, so that they were not really connected to each other. And another one was their rigidity, that they were programmed to do certain things, and if you have to change it, it becomes a royal pain. So it's not surprising that, you know, a big emphasis in ERP was on integration and flexibility. Okay? So it's interesting to remark that when people looked at that, so they saw the weaknesses. You also have to understand what their strengths are. And one of the major strengths of those systems was often overlooked. So what was the strength of those older systems? Well, very often their strength was that they were really fast and efficient. So they didn't have the luxury of dealing with modern interfaces or anything, but they were designed in such a way that whatever, if you have to do certain things there, and the system is designed so that you can do those things, you can do them really fast. Okay? And people were really, really efficient in doing those well-defined tasks that were programmed in the system. So when people implemented new ERP systems, in many cases, to their surprise, they discovered that the performance, particularly initially, went down. Okay, why? Because the systems were, you know, integrated, complex systems, very flexible. But then you have to juggle a lot of screens to enter certain things in the system that you could enter in the old system on a single screen, just going field to field to field very, very fast. Okay, so it's important not to overlook. So you have to keep it in your mind. Those systems, they always will have some weaknesses. It's not that, you know, they're only bad. They're not bad. I mean, people have been using them for a long time, so it means that they must be good for something. And try to, at the very least, to match it. Okay, what else? Feasibility analysis, yeah. So after you figure out what the requirements are, what the system has to do, you have to ask, you have to get an answer to this very important question. Can this be done? So this comes in the form of feasibility analysis. There are actually three different aspects of feasibility analysis. The first and the most obvious one is technological feasibility. Can this be done? Okay? But that's not the only question. Another big question is the economic feasibility that should come to your mind as an accountant, because you really have to think about the dollar signs. So does it make sense to do from a purely economic point of view? Because there are a lot of things that we can do, but is it going to be just a waste of money? Okay, so we're going to be talking about this. And finally, there is a trickier question, which probably, my guess is, you have never encountered before, which is called organizational feasibility. So I'll talk about that. Okay. So let's talk about this. So what is this economic feasibility? Well, I assume that in some of your introductory courses, you already talked about this. So this is a project which will require certain investments, right? And then to decide whether it's worth it or not, you have to see what you get out of it, right? So the crudest way of answering this question is the so-called payback period calculation. Why do I call it crudest? Well, because when people do this very rough payback period calculation, they usually ignore the time value of money. So they say, okay, it will cost me so many dollars to build and deploy it. I think that I'm going to be back getting this in return, and then later this in return. So if it all adds up, if what I get in return exceeds what I pay, then let's consider it economically feasible. So obviously, this is not the correct way of looking at this, because you know that $1 today is not exactly the same as $1 tomorrow. Right? So you really have to take into account the time value of money. And you can do it in two dual ways. They're actually mathematically they're equivalent. So one is called net present value analysis, and the other one is called calculating the internal rate of return. So in net present value analysis, you assume that you know what the time value of money is. Basically, you know the discount factor, right? So how much cheaper a dollar will be, let's say, a year from now, right? So how do you do this net present value calculation? You have to estimate your cash flows, right? You have to estimate the amounts of money that you put in and when, and you also have to estimate the benefits in monetary terms and when you get it. So flows in and flows out, right? Then you discount them based on the time when they occur. So you basically what you do, you calculate discounted cash flow, right? Add them all up. And then how can you decide if it is worth it? So when you add them all up, you end up with a net present value, right? Which is the project and the return on this project expressed in today's dollars, right? So you, the project is worthwhile if, what? If the net present value is positive. So whether when you add up those, they have so inflows go with a minus sign. I'm sorry, outflows go with a minus sign, inflows go with a plus sign. So discounted cash flows. If the net present value is positive, this is a good project. Alternatively, this is a dual way of seeing it. You can calculate the internal rate of return on this project, right? So you still estimate the flows, right? What cash goes in and when, what cash flows out and when. But when you do net, internal rate of return calculation, right? So your unknown is what? The discount, yes, the interest, the discount factor, right? Which is the power, you know, that when you discount. So you set up an equation where the unknown is this interest, and the equation is that the your total discounted cash flow equals what? You have to set up an equation to solve it for this, for the interest rate. So the equation is that you add up those discounted flows, where the discount is the unknown. But the equation is that this sum equals what? Yes, it equals zero, right? So basically the internal rate of return is that interest rate that makes the net present value of this project equal zero, right? And you solve this equation for this interest rate, right? So you calculate this interest rate, and then you decide whether this project is worthwhile based on what? Whether this interest rate
is greater than the interest rate that you got from setting up.
No, no. Whether this interest rate that you get out of the project,
yes,
exceeds your internal rate of return.
Yes.
So you have a number of other ways of making money. So if this project generates better return, and better return means higher interest rate than the other things, then this is a good project. Mathematically, this is equivalent. Two and three are equivalent, so it doesn't matter. You can do it either way. So what do you think about this? So it sounds like a fairly easy calculation. By the way, this is really done. You know that, have you heard this expression, ROI?
Return on investment.
Return on investment, yes. So this is basically more or less what we talked about. If you read professional literature about this, then you you'll see that people say that, well, you cannot really sell system development projects to the top management based on ROI. So you can find it in many, many professional articles. So we have it in the chapter of the textbook where it says, okay, you have to calculate the economic feasibility. In real life, this is actually really tough. Can you guess why? So what I discuss now, I mean, these calculations, this is your textbook stuff. My guess is that was your introduction to finance, or something like that,
yes,
right?
Introduction to finance and cost accounting.
Yeah, so this guy. Okay, so what's the problem with this? And unfortunately, system professionals, they face this issue pretty much all the time. So there is a problem here. Well, they don't mention it in the textbook. It's not something which can be discussed in the textbook. But in real life, it's a big issue.
Problem with using this method?
Yeah. Well, yeah, yes, when you use this method, yes. You will encounter certain difficulties. Yes?
Well, does having the work to be done and also future factors or natural disasters?
You're on the right track. Now, I wouldn't go as far as to talk about natural disasters, right? So when you run a business, I mean, who knows what's going to happen, right? Could anybody predict that Sandy would be as devastating?
Is it because of the uncertainties related to the project?
Correct. But what kind? You both talk about the uncertainty means that, you know, you cannot predict the future. What is most difficult to predict? So when we are talking about this project, there are actually two separate things here. So when you are talking about this calculated, this discounted cash flow, certain things are easier to predict than some other things. They're still uncertain, by the way. Don't get me wrong. All those things are just estimates, right? And those estimates can be off significantly. But certain things there are more uncertain than some other things, and much more difficult to predict. And that's it. Because, you know, uncertainty affects any business project. So, okay, maybe I didn't make myself clear. If you're running a business, you're planning something for the future, you're gonna have to deal with uncertainty no matter what, no matter which project you're running. So this is no different in any other areas. So here, I want to draw to your attention to something which is peculiar to these projects, to new information system development projects, in contrast to other projects. So there is a particular difficulty here, which is not faced when you evaluate other projects. And yes, whatever project you evaluate, it's about the future. You're gonna have to deal with uncertainty. But here there is something which is particularly difficult, which really complicates the methods. Okay, it's difficult for you to guess, so let me tell you. Yes, we are facing uncertainty, but we can make pretty good estimates of how much it will cost us and when we have to put the money in. We can figure out what the license fees are, we can estimate now pretty well how many people we have to get and to pay them to do this and all this stuff. So time spent on training. So the money that goes into the project can be estimated fairly well. Of course, with uncertainty, not precisely, but fairly well. The real problem is to estimate what you're going to get out of this project. So you know that when we talk about this economic feasibility, you know you have to calculate discounted cash flow. So there is money that goes in and there is money that comes out. Okay, of the project. So the money that you get out of this is almost impossible to estimate. Why? Well, because information systems are pervasive. There is this term. They affect absolutely everything in the enterprise. Okay, so for example, your old system didn't provide any transparency about tracking customers' orders. So customers placed an order, they had to place some calls. Those people had to dig somewhere to figure out, for example, what is the estimated time when the order is going to be fulfilled. So you're deploying this new information system, and it is now transparent. A customer can go in, can trace the stages of the order, and can get out of the system a really good estimate of the estimated of the arrival time. Is it valuable to the customers? What do you think? So you place an order. Would it be valuable to you? Yes or no? I mean, it's an easy question. The answer is yes, of course it is valuable. The difficult question is how much. So the real difficult question is, okay, so yeah, it is valuable. To us, when we deploy this, does it mean that we are going to get more business as a result of this? How do you separate this from other things that you do? Okay? So the benefit, so it is much easier to quantify the costs, and it is much, much more difficult to quantify the benefits. So when you are dealing with these systems, that putting a dollar sign on what you are going to get out of this, okay? How much new business you are going to get. In some cases, you, for example, you know that you waste a lot of inventory. Why? Because certain things are expired. So you put a new system, you can estimate that actually that inventory write-offs have to be reduced by so. There are some things that you can estimate. But there are other things that are very, very difficult to estimate. So that's why most new system development projects are not really sold on their ROI. They are more sold on the strategic considerations, saying that, okay, this is where it is going, so we have to provide these capabilities and all that. And if you don't do this, you're going to be in trouble. So you are a retailer, you see that Amazon is eating your lunch, right? So you want to deploy electronic commerce. So you are Walmart. Is it worth your while? You already have a very sophisticated system, your stores are doing fine. But you notice that actually, you know, those customers, that Amazon starts eating your lunch because they're watching what you're doing and they try to undercut you on price. So then you put an electronic commerce system in place and you actually keep watching each other, right? So did you ever notice if you're the same product is sold by Amazon and Walmart, that very often the price is exactly the same to the penny. You realize that it's not done manually, right? That you realize that they all have programs, you know, watching each other. So those adjustments are done automatically. You also realize that Walmart tried to capitalize on their physical presence advantage, right? So they said, okay, you can place an order online and come to the store and pick it up the same day. And then Amazon started deploying same-day deliveries in some areas. You know that they do same-day deliveries in Manhattan. By the way, you know that Amazon now has their own delivery service. Right? You know, so basically UPS and FedEx, maybe, and USPS may be in trouble. So it's very interesting, you know. So, for example, USPS just deployed something new. I don't know if you have it. You know, I am signed up. You know that every day now, I get an email from United States Postal Service that shows me a fairly low resolution scanned images of the mail I am supposed to get that day. I don't know, is there anybody else who is getting this? Okay, you can register with USPS, probably they will start. No, they started a couple of weeks, I think, so I started getting this. Most of that is, by the way, junk mail. I'm really amazed that they're really scanning all that junk and sending me email with those images. Yeah, but this is, it's actually very interesting. So I keep this in mind, that when you deploy these systems, this is something that will affect the whole enterprise. You think people will start working faster? Can you quantify it? Can you quantify time savings so that people now can look up something in the system instead of calling somebody up? So what is the return on this? How do you estimate this? Is there any question? Because you know, it's kind of this is a discussion that we often have with our MBA students. But here, I mean, just to give you a flavor of what is going on. Any questions about this? Okay. Okay, systems design. So this is our bread and butter. This is what we're going to be actually starting in detail in this class. So what do you do when you design a system? Well, first, you will have to create the so-called logical model of the data. So this class focuses a lot on business data. And logical data modeling is a very, very big part of what we're going to be doing in this class. And of course, it's a big part of what people are doing. So after you create the logical data model, you have to think about how this data is processed. And you'll have to create some kind of a processing model. We're going to be using an exceedingly simple process model. In some cases, people actually use more sophisticated models, but this is just a limitation of this class. So we're going to be using a very, very simple model. Then people do model integration. So what does it mean? Basically, you have a data model, you have a process model, you have to make sure that they map, one maps to another. Then you take those logical models, which, by the way, really have nothing to do with any specific database. They're just abstract models. And you have to translate them into what we call physical models, which is dependent on the type of the database that you work with. So in our case, we're going to be translating them into the physical model in a relational database, right? And as far as the physical models of the process are concerned, we're going to be using the tools provided by Access to map those logical models. Then you have to document the models and the feasibility analysis. So let's take it one by one. So what is this logical data model? The way we see it and present in this course is based on the methodology which was developed in the mid-1970s. I told you that the abstract relational model was published in 1970, but it was not, and Codd, when he published the model, he thought that it would be something which would be easy for the for regular people to use. You know, people who are immersed in mathematics and computer science, they don't really understand that other people don't use that language. So that regular people use just much more imprecise language. For them, I mean, set theory is something which is really, really too abstract. So Codd's ambitions never had any chance to be realized. And it was understood very early on. So that's the reason why a simplified graphical modeling methodology was developed in the mid-1970s. And the name associated with the development of this methodology is Peter Chen, who published a book about entity relationship modeling. I believe the book was published in 1976, if I'm not mistaken. And we are basically following what was proposed then. So what is this? This is what says the fourth book. A useful way of thinking about the data in relation to databases is to think in terms of entities and their relationships. So what kind of entities you should represent in your database, and what kind of relationships they have. So for example, we're dealing with, a university system. So there are a number of different entities. There may be an entity of students, it's one kind of entity. There is another kind of entity, is entity of classes, right? They actually have a relationship because students take certain classes, right? There can be other entities. For example, there can be entities of instructors that will also be in a relationship with classes because instructors teach them. Right? There may be other entities like academic departments, and instructors can be in a relationship with academic departments because they don't just teach on their own, they teach in a certain department. Right? Bless you. So this methodology is very, very simple. Again, it's shown graphically. It uses rectangles to represent entities, and it uses diamonds to represent relationships. Now, at this level, this is just too simplistic. So we actually need to provide a little bit more detail here, right? And those details were provided into something which was called extended entity relationship model. Extended entity relationship diagrams. So if standard entity relationship diagrams show only entities and their relationships, then extended entity relationship diagrams show additional information, like a set of attributes. So entities will be represented by their set of attributes. And some of those attributes will be chosen as primary keys, right? So all that is shown in the extended entity relationship diagram. Right? Then relationships have certain properties, and we'll discuss them shortly. Those properties are known as the optionality and cardinality of those relationships. So extended entity relationship diagram show the properties of the relationships as well. So let's take a look at this diagram. Okay, here actually it shows in a little bit more detail what I started talking about. So if you are talking about this university system, then not only you have an entity of students and an entity of courses, but there is also this entity of registrations. Okay. Registrations are very interesting because those are actually events that happen in the system, right? So what is a registration? So every term, you make a decision that you're going to sign up for such and such classes, right? So actually, it's very similar to a business transaction. Right? It's almost like, you know, placing an order. Okay, so you'll see the analogies later on. So therefore, registration is a separate entity. And also you can see on this diagram that we actually assign names to entities and to their relationships. So there is this entity of courses, entity of registrations, entity of students, right? We also say that this relationship, we say is for, and this relationship is why. So obviously the words are chosen in such a way that it should be easy for us to read it. And here, I want to give you a warning. So when you attempt to construct a sentence in English that reads this relationship, it may create a wrong impression that there is some kind of directionality on the entity relationship diagram, because it is natural for me to read it like registrations are for courses, right? So I read it from the registration side to the course side. And this is a wrong impression. Entity relationship diagrams are non-directional. So keep that in mind. Again, if you just look at the words describing them, it may create a wrong impression that it goes from one side to the other side. There is nothing like that. They are absolutely non-directional. We will start distinguishing between different sides of the relationship when we talk about the properties of the relationship. But just purely based on the words, you cannot say anything. It's coincidental. In the same way as I said that registrations are by students, right? Again, it sounds like I go from registrations to students. It's non-directional. There is no directionality. Is this clear? Good. We'll talk about that more. Don't worry about this. We'll get this. This is something that you will have to do. So we'll cover this in detail. This is just a very, very brief introduction. The process model. So as I said, it's a very simple one. It's known as data flow diagrams. It uses only four symbols. It uses circles to represent processes, arrows to represent the direction of flows, rectangles to represent sources and destinations of information, open-sided rectangles to represent storage. Basically, what data flow diagrams show is simply how the information flows. And they give a description of what is going on. Data flow diagrams do not show any logic of information processing. So there is, you know that when you do information processing, usually you would have some kind of logical conditions, if, then, else, and so nothing like that is shown on data flow diagrams. They just show this basic structure that you get this information here and something like this is done. Then it flows there and there that is done. Okay? So this is the crudest possible way of representing. Okay? And you will see that there will be a very natural integration. So we will discuss, there will be a fairly precise instruction set telling you that if you have an entity relationship diagram, then you should expect to see this, this, and that on the data flow diagram. Okay? So the difficult part, so when you start working on the projects, the difficult part will be to come up with a logical data model. The process model more or less will follow. So that's not good. It's going to be a fairly mechanical process, right? So we are going to be mapping entities on the entity relationship diagrams to the processes on the data flow diagram. Okay? And you will see that process event entities will have high-level processes. So this is an example of a data flow diagram. So you see that actually what happens here. We had registrations. Remember there was a registration event on the entity relationship diagram. So there is this registration process. So this is where the processing of registrations takes place, right? So you see that the active part, the source and the destination here is the students. So this open, this rectangle, represents the sources of information and in this case also the destinations of information flows. And also you see some storage here. So courses and registration. So in the old days they would say that this was the courses file and this was the registrations file. In the modern database management system you will see that there will be a table called courses where the information will be stored. And there will be another table called registrations, where the records of registrations will be stored. Okay? Any questions about this? By the way, data flow diagrams will be hierarchical. It would be very difficult to represent on a single diagram the detail, the necessary details of information processing. So we'll start with the zoomed out view. Okay, so this big picture view, and then we'll zoom in on the certain fragments of data. So you, we will talk about the so-called context diagram, level zero diagram, level one diagram, and so on and so forth. So it will be a hierarchical model, but it's going to be a fairly simple one. Questions? Yes?
Our registry is next week.
Say it again?
Registrations next week.
Are you talking about the sprint term? I have no clue. No idea. I don't know. I don't think so. I think registrations will probably be in November, no? Huh?
Early.
Say it again?
I think so early.
It's a little bit early, yeah. You come on, you just registered for this one.
I know.
Have all the fun here. You'll start thinking about the next round.
Maybe for seniors.
Oh yeah, maybe for seniors.
Okay, this is, well, it's not new anymore. As I said, we didn't have time to talk about object-oriented programming languages because we didn't cover chapter 4. And then I mentioned very, very briefly object-oriented databases. But in general, it's the modern development methodology. Now, when people develop information systems, they often use this object-oriented development methodology. Most modern programming languages are object-oriented languages, starting with C++ and Java and C# and all that stuff. Now, there is a well-developed graphical methodology for object-oriented development. It's called Unified Modeling Language. And there are, it's a very, very powerful tool. There are tools that support, programmatic tools that support it. There was something called National Roads, which now belongs to IBM. There is a part of this which is very similar to what we're going to be using here. So there are different diagrams in UML. There is something called class diagrams, which are very similar to our empty relationship model. So this slide is just for your information only, just to introduce you to this so that you're aware of some of the terminology. So object-oriented modeling uses a somewhat different terminology. So what we call entity will be called class. By the way, the term object-oriented development, in a way, is kind of a misnomer. Because when people do this, they don't develop objects. They develop classes. So a more meaningful name would be not object-oriented modeling, but class-oriented modeling. But for historical reasons, it's called object-oriented modeling. But actually, the analog of entities is class. Okay? The big difference is that when we talk about entities, we talk only about the data aspect. And when they talk about class, they also talk about the data aspect, but they also talk about the methods, the processing that is going to be done on that data. So the programmatic part. So a class is this thing that which encapsulates not only the data, but also that those processing routines. Okay, but anyway, so that the analog of entity is class. What we will call an instance of entity will be called an object. So again, so what is an instance of entity? Probably here for the first time. So you remember I mentioned that, okay, so an example of an entity is students, right? So what is an instance of an entity of students? An instance of an entity of student is a particular student. It's going to be a description. So a particular student is an instance of an entity of students. An entity of students is this generic concept, okay? A particular student is an instance of that concept. So the same thing. So in object-oriented development, there will be a class called students, and a particular student that will be worked with will be an object of that class. Okay, so that's just the analogy. So what we call relationships, they call associations. The same thing. No difference. Okay, more of it. And then attributes are attributes. Well, we also call them fields. We also have some other ones. Okay. So again, this is just the mapping. Know that it exists. Actually, software developers these days use that. The reason why you also see it here, because there has been a debate in our community whether these courses should be taught using this UML notation. So there have been some people who are promoting this, saying that, you know, this is the modern thing, and actually we really should be showing this, not the way it is shown here, which is anti-relationship. Conceptually, I don't think it makes a big difference. It's just a more modern representation of it. And it may be a little bit more complicated. So I don't know. I don't really have a position on this, since most of our textbooks still stay with entity relationship modeling. So if you open pretty much any accounting information systems textbook, you'll see that we still use this empty relationship modeling. So we stay with it. Maybe in the future those textbooks will be updated and will switch to this UML approach. I don't know. I don't think it will make a difference. Just a fancier way of showing. Okay, what is physical design? Well, as I said, that logical models are just pure abstractions. when we have to implement them, we have to have something very specific. So what does it mean? Well, it means that, say, in the case of a data model, the logical data model, which is empty relation diagram, has to be converted to a physical model, which in this case will be a database schema. So what is a relational database schema? You already saw examples of it before. This is basically a description of the database, a listing of the tables with the names given to the tables, with the attributes of the tables listed, with the primary keys defined, with the properties of the, with the type of the attributes defined, with the relationship, foreign keys defined, all that stuff. So this is what a physical data model. So, and this is actually what we need. This is what you will need. When you create a database in Microsoft Access, you will need this. You cannot just take that graphical model and just say, okay, then what? What is the database? So you need a physical model. So this is what the problem of physical design is. So we have to take logical models and we have to map them to physical models. So in the case of empty relationship diagrams, so they will be mapped to tables and the relationship between those tables. In the case of data flow diagrams, you will have to design forms and reports based on the data flow diagrams. Again, as a very brief advertisement, this is not going to be a difficult part. The difficult part will be the creation of the empty relationship model. As far as this step is concerned, we are going to give you, again, a very, very precise and detailed set of instructions, saying, okay, you got this empty relationship diagram, now you are supposed to do this mapping in such and such a way. As a matter of fact, that you'll see that the set of instructions is so detailed that in a way you can write a program that does it. Okay, and actually there are programs that do this. Okay, so this has to be done, and this is what you will have to do to create the actual databases. But this is not something very, very good. So then what else? Documentation. A critical part in developing information systems. When an information system is deployed and delivered, there has to be a document describing that information system in details. Okay. So this is actually challenging because those people who are very good at writing code usually are not very good at writing readable text. So this is just an empirical observation. I don't want to insult anybody or draw any kind of conclusions, but this is the reality. If you have a star programmer who is really, really good at this, I would take a bet that that star programmer is probably not a very good writer of conventional text. So you cannot really make those people write system documentation. You can force them, you're not gonna be happy with the results. So that would be a bad idea. So what do people typically do? Well, there is a special, actually, profession called technical writer. People who actually write those documents. And by the way, most of them are not computer science majors. Most of them are English majors. So it's easier to find English majors who will understand technology sufficiently well to write good documentation rather than to find good programmers who will be able to write text well enough so that people can read it. So this is how it usually happens. Now, it is also a requirement these days that people try to make the code self-documented. So when people write code, they try to make sure that they put comments in the code, which is also, it's very difficult to force people to do that, to make the code self-documented using very long variable names, descriptive subroutine names. So there is all this push. Again, it is often very, very difficult to achieve, but this is what people try to do. It is critical, mostly because of human nature, but critical and difficult because of human nature. Now, feasibility analysis. As I said, there will be this feedback loop. It will often involve feasibility analysis. So now you do this design part. You have a much better idea of what is required and what is involved. And often you have to go back and discuss more about it. By the way, organizational, I forgot to mention. I mentioned very briefly organizational feasibility. You remember we talked about it. So what is this creature, organizational feasibility? So technological is clear, economic is clear. What is organizational? This is this very subtle thing, how the new system fits into your organizational structure. And again, this is a high level discussion, but in many cases it is critical. Why would people care? Well, because information is power. And you know, in any large organization, you know, it is always, there is some kind of power structure. You know, pecking order, who is at what level. And if you know something, that usually creates your power base. If you deploy a new system, it will change it. Because it will change who knows what. And very often, it affects the position of people. So many people will have a vested interest in fighting the system. So again, it's going to be probably above your pay grade, particularly in the beginning. Just keep it in mind that, you know, if you have to call somebody to find out something, then, you know, those people will expect something in return. And if you deploy a system where you don't have to call them anymore, you go into computer and can simply look up something, those people may get upset. Okay, may not like that system very much. So may have other ideas. So that was actually, I wanted to mention. So, okay, a couple of minutes. So let's start system development. So what do you do here? Well, this is where the technical stuff takes place. So after you have done this conceptual part, so you created this conceptual model of your data, you translated it into a physical model, so you have clear structure in the database. Now you can actually create those data structures. So you can get into the database, you can create the tables, you can create the attributes, you can specify primary keys. This is where, in your case, you're going to start clicking, okay? In the actual system development case, this is where people will start writing create tables, sentences, and SQL, okay? Also then take the structure of the process, see how the information has to be processed, and do the detailed programming. Okay, again, so this is this most technical part of this. So what is not so technical? Well, you have to test it, user training, and visibility analysis. Okay, let's talk about this. Now, as I said, we will give you a fairly precise set of instructions. The table names will be already known, the field names will be already known, the primary keys will be already defined in the database schema, the relationship, the foreign keys will be defined. There are certain things here that I have to mention, and this is a peculiarity of Microsoft Access. When you define relationships, Access gives you this option that I don't know if this what the default is. It used to be that by default, relationships in Microsoft Access were not enforced, which is a very bad idea because then it means it's not really a relationship. So that's why you see this point here that you have to make sure that referential integrity is enforced. You will also have to define validation rules. So will be discussed in more details when we talk about controls. So validation rules are all about controls. So this is where you also have to define this. And detailed programming. So as they say, you have to create those interfaces that the users will use to put the data in and get the data out.